some failures in of aircraft wings. But the thing that really made us understand, especially flutter, one of the things we're going to talk about is flutter. There's a gentleman here who works on bridges. So one very famous bridge in Washington State in U.S. is called Tacoma's Narrows Bridge. It starts to flutter at a certain frequency, certain airspeed, and it starts to vibrate so bad because of the airflow over it that it collapsed. Okay, so understanding why that bridge collapsed really made us understand this phenomena called flutter, and we will spend some time on flutter. So fluid flow is very important for us. So some of you want to do aerodynamics, so we can do this aeroelasticity without knowing aerodynamics. Structure is very important to us. The overall theory of elasticity is very important in the sense, how do wings behave? Okay, we are mostly interested in wings, even though the same theories that we apply to wings are equally applicable to bridges. Okay, so just the basic physics would be a little different, but the basic ideas of unsteady aerodynamics are same. So the third thing you all need to know is structural dynamics. What happens to a structure when you give it a small oscillation? What happens to it? It vibrates, right? And that's interaction between inertia forces and elasticity forces. Okay, so inertia wants to keep on moving in one direction. After a certain time, structure does not want to move any further. It pulls it back, and then it pulls it back so much, then it goes all the way into the other direction and keep on going back and forth. Okay, that's structural dynamics or vibrations. So interaction of all those things, and then you add this concept of stability. How many of you know what stability is? What do we mean by some system is stable or unstable? What does it mean to you? One person at a time. It is stable, right? I mean, that's what stability is, that if somehow we go a little bit off from our equilibrium position, and if we come back to our natural, there is enough tendency in us to come back to our natural position, we call that system to be stable. Okay, so it's called statically stable, because that's the tendency itself. All it tells you is that you will have a tendency to go back where you came from. Now it's entirely possible that you may overshoot that and now go in the other direction and come back, and in every cycle, even though you are statically stable, that you are coming back, but you are overshooting, and in every cycle you might be increasing your amplitude. So you could be statically stable but dynamically unstable. Okay, so flutter is a dynamically unstable phenomena. So what happens is, at a certain speed, the structure starts to get so much air, so much energy from the system, that whatever damping it has, it overcomes that, right? So it starts to extract energy from the system, and as a result, it starts to oscillate more and more in every cycle, till it either fails, or because of nonlinearities, it comes to some kind of what we call limit cycle oscillation. That means it develops an oscillation, but it's at a certain amplitude. It cannot increase that amplitude. Okay, but many times it keeps on increasing amplitude in every cycle till it fails. If it's a limit cycle oscillation, it would simply fatigue after a certain time. Okay, that's a different kind of failure than flutter is. Okay. So those are some of the issues we're going to study in this course. Okay, so let's first start with the what we call static aeroelasticity, right? So like we said, aeroelasticity is an interaction process between aerodynamics. Like somebody said, aerodynamics is really a study of you don't have to, you can take notes, but I'm going to leave these slides with Dr. Sunny, and he said he will forward them to you after this class or this evening. So it's interaction between aerodynamics and structures, right? And when it's time independent, that time does not play any role, or like you said, inertia is not important, okay, things happen so slow that the system does not have a chance to develop any kind of inertial forces. You know, if something moves very slowly, there are very little inertia forces. Only when you move things very fast, you have to worry about inertia, right? Because mass, inertia means mass. Mass does not want to move fast. It's like us, you know, we don't want to really move fast unless somebody pushes us. So we will ignore all time dependent effects. That means inertia is not important, and it really is then interaction between aerodynamic forces and elastic forces. Then we have dynamic aeroelastic phenomena. That's time dependent, right? That means now inertia would play a role, and it involves interactions among inertial forces. By inertial forces, we mean that system has a mass, right, or mass moment of inertia. Aerodynamic, again, what fluid flow will do to the structure, and the elastic forces, okay. So, what distinguishes aeroelasticity from your regular structural analysis is, when I sit on this chair, whatever my weight is, that is the load acting on this chair, okay. It does not change. Just because the structure has deformed, the load does not change, it remains same, okay. Whereas in wings, this is not what happens. In the wings, what happens is, one of the things we will talk about is, when you have a wing, if you draw a cross section of it, it looks like this. Right, and when the air comes, it's going to come and it goes like this. It goes over here. Goes like this. And these two are called stagnation points. Okay, so when the flows like this, the air speed on the top surface is higher than the air speed on the lower surface. Okay. As a result, the pressure from, how many of you know Bernoulli's equation? Okay, most of you. So, from Bernoulli's equation, pressure on the upper surface is lesser than pressure on the upper surface is lesser than pressure on the lower surface. So, as a result, you develop some lift. Okay, we call it lift. That is the lift that lets an airplane go up from the ground, right? I mean lift. But that is not all you get. You also get what we call drag, right. It is, as you can, as you put your hand in water, you know it is hard to move it, same thing. So, moving this airfoil in the air is not cost free. You have to do some work, right. You have to overcome some resistance. That resistance to movement in the air of this wing is called drag, okay. So, this is lift and this is drag, all right. Another thing that happens is, because the lift, you can find a point at which you will not have any moment. But generally, when you look at the pressure distribution, we look at a very specific point in airfoil, and we will talk about that, and that is called aerodynamic center. Okay. So, if this was what we call center of pressure, then lift would be the only vertical force you will have, drag would be only horizontal force you would have, you will not have any moment. Okay. So, you will not have any something that is trying to pitch the nose up or pitch the nose down. But in general, because the pressure distribution on a wing is on the top surface something like that, on the lower surface something like that. Except at that one point we call center of pressure, that if I look at resultant at any other points, I would not only see lift and drag, I would also see what we call moment. Okay. So you also develop what is called moment, aerodynamic moment. That means the air is also trying to either pull the nose up or pull the nose down, depending on, but generally it is the nose down, but then we consider it positive when we have nose up kind of moment. Okay. So, that is a positive direction. Okay, so that's what we are interested in when we try to design an aircraft wing, that what is the lift, because you have to raise the weight of the airplane, so you have to have lift equal to weight, right? You want to know what the drag is, because that would tell you what kind of thrust level you engine you need, right? So thrust, you have to have enough thrust to match your drag, right? So thrust is a force in the that pulls it forward, and drag is that doesn't want it to move forward, right? So when they balance only, then you can move forward. And same thing with lift and weight. When lift equal to weight, thrust equal to drag, that's when the airplane is flying, right? Now, what's different about this kind of wing structure? This is your wing structure, right? And your normal structure is that there is a point also in the wing, we call it elastic axis. Okay. It's also called locus of shear centers. So shear center of a cross, okay, now if you look at a wing, it consists of a box beam, okay? A wing is really an outer surface, outer thin line, skin like this, and a big box here. These are called spars. This is a spar, this is another spar, and this is kind of big beam, right? And then this thin skin, and then you also have what we call stringers going in, they provide stiffness. So this is how a wing cross section look like, okay? So if two or three big beams, they are the ones that would resist all your bending. And because you, I told you, you also have this moment, that means this beam would also like to twist, okay? If it would like to twist, you need something that can prevent that twisting. What's the best way to prevent twisting of any structure? What is shear center? Okay, so that's what we call shear center. So one way to not worry about torsion is make sure your loads are applied to the shear center. So if I apply lift from that point, it will not twist, right? But the problem is that's not where the lift is acting. Lift acts at what we call aerodynamic center, okay? Whereas elastic axis would be somewhere here. So they are in general at two different points, okay? But that's one question I was asking. The other question is, assuming that I cannot let torsion go to zero, then what's the best way to resist torque? Huh? What is anti-torque? No, let's say I cannot do that. Let's suppose there is a torque there and I have to now design some kind of structure that will resist that torque. Well, again, no, that is not, I'm not resisting torque. That again, I'm reducing the value of torque. What I'm saying is, let's say I cannot reduce the value of torque. What kind of structure have you guys seen so far where you have reduced the value of torque? I think some kind of hollow, because you don't want, you can always have a very solid circular rod, right? I mean, if you look at axle of your wheels, they resist torque and they are solid rods. I cannot use that kind of heavy stuff in aircraft, okay? Because one of the best thing we try to do in airplanes is, wherever possible, even if we do our best to reduce the weight of the structures. Because anytime I can reduce a couple of 100 pounds, I can put one more passenger in there, right? So aircraft designers look for every place where they can reduce the weight of the structure, okay? So that means you only want as much material as you need, nothing less, nothing more. Nothing more would make your airplane inefficient, okay, very costly to run, and anything less means accidents, people will die, right? So we that's the balance you have to have, that safety first, cost second, but still cost cannot be infinite, right? So cost cannot be infinite, so you have to make those kind of balances. That's why we have things like safety factors and all that. But so like somebody said, it's a hollow tube. Hollow tubes are the best to resist torque, and we will talk about that a little bit. I'll give you that. So this is what this guy does over here. It's called wing box. Okay, it's a wing box. It's like a hollow tube. Okay, because I cannot go outside this state. I need this shape. If I do not have this cross section, I cannot develop lift. Okay, so to develop lift, I have to have a shape like this. So I have to live with a box that would fit this airfoil, right? So far so good. So wing really resists two main loads, bending. Okay, many of you have taken course on deforms or mechanics of materials or strength of materials. So everybody knows how a beam behaves, right? So I want you to refresh your knowledge of beam theory when you go home today. How many of you have also studied how do thin walled structures resist torque? Okay, and I'll spend some time on that too. So that's the other key thing. Okay, how do we resist torque? Okay, so a wing basically resists bending, and that's done by these big beams and the skin too. But skin because of torque. Okay, most of the bending stresses are carried by these spar caps. These are big solid pieces over here. And these stringers, okay, they're all very good at carrying axial stress, right? If you think about it, what is bending? It is axial stress that is going from some minus compressive load to the maximum tensile load, and then resultant of that is our bending moment, right? So what you want to do is this, because there's a difference between shear center and the lift, we are interested in what happens around the elastic axis. So there is some torque because of this lift. Okay. Now, why is aero? I mean, it's not a big deal, right? So what if there's a lift, there's a torque there, and I have this box designed, and I can resist that torque. So what's the problem? The problem is this lift. If you write an expression for this, it looks like 1/2 rho v square s c l. Rho is density of the air, that means lift is proportional to the density of the medium in which your wing is moving. If it's air, it's air. If it's in water, it's water. So it depends, it's proportional to rho. Okay, rho of the medium, in this case rho of air. And you can also imagine it's going to definitely depend on velocity. If you move faster, we don't know if it's a square or whatever, but if you do a dimensional analysis, how many of you have ever done dimensional analysis? Oh, very good. So if you do a dimensional analysis, you would see that lift would come out to be on the right hand side, it would come out to be proportional to v square. Okay, and then s is overall surface area of the wing, and cl is lift coefficient. Okay, so this cl is very interesting. Okay, it's the lift coefficient for, and it depends on the shape of the airfoil. It depends on at what Reynolds number you are. Reynolds number, it depends on viscosity and inertia forces ratio, and it depends on, there is one very important part in aerodynamics. There are two key important numbers. One is called Reynolds number. What's the other one? Mach number, right? Mach number is this actual speed of the airplane to the speed of sound. Okay, speed of sound plays a big role in airplane design. Okay. Why is that? Why do you think? Why should anybody care what the sound speed is, and what has that got to do with airplanes? What is speed of sound really is at heart? What's the basic concept of sound, speed of sound? That's supersonic flow. That's not what I'm asking. What I am asking is, what is the basic principle that we care about when we worry about speed of sound? What is speed of sound? That is the key part. Okay. So if there is a disturbance in the air, at what speed it travels, that is speed of sound. And it is important for us, because if it is a, if airplane is traveling at a certain speed, it is going to keep on continuously emitting those disturbances, right. Based on those disturbances, air in front of it sort of knows, before the wing comes, the air knows something is coming. Okay, because you have sent a disturbance, you have sent piece of information, I am coming. But that only happens if the speed of the aircraft is less than speed of sound. If you are flying it faster than speed of sound, air in front of you would not even know what hit it, right. Suddenly you are going to be there, it had no chance to find out you are coming. Okay. So that is why speed of sound is very important, because it completely changes the loads acting on an airplane, whether you are flying low subsonic, transonic. Transonic is when Mach number is between 0.85 to 1.2. I mean, that is the most difficult aerodynamics flow to calculate. Supersonic is easy, subsonic is easy. Subsonic is basically, we can assume flow is incompressible. Incompressible is really like assuming speed of sound is infinite, because our actual speed is so low compared to speed of sound, it might as well be infinite. Okay. So, those kind of analysis are called incompressible flow analysis, and we use that a lot. Anytime Mach number airplane is flying close to 0.6 up to 0.6, 0.7, people still can use incompressible. Okay. I mean, it is not a great assumption, but it is not a bad assumption either. Okay. So that is why speed of sound is important. All these aerodynamic forces depend on those two key things, the Mach number and the Reynolds number, because Reynolds number brings in viscosity and all that. But it also depends on two other things, which are, we haven't talked about it. What's the shape of the airplane, of the wing? Okay. And when we talk about shape of the wing, we talk about two things. One is, at what angle I am placing, what is this angle? Okay. So, this angle is very, very important for us. The other thing that is important is, if this is a mean line, I mean, sorry, this is straight line, and I also now draw a mean line of the airfoil, that means around that line, dashed line, whatever thickness I have over here, I will have the same thickness on this side. Okay. This distance, maximum distance of mean line from this straight line that joins the front point and the back point, is called camber. Okay. So, camber and angle of attack are very important for us. Okay. Now, camber does not change. Okay. I mean, when I place an airfoil in the air, but the angle of attack can change. I mean, you think you put the aircraft at 3 degrees angle of attack. I mean, that's all we are talking about. These angle of attacks are not large numbers. Okay. They are 5, 6, 10 degrees kind of numbers. They are not very large numbers. You think you have put the angle of attack at 3 degrees. What might happen if the airplane was, the wing was not rigid? If the airplane is not rigid, that means the torsional stiffness. Anybody, you all told me that you know what bending is, what torsion is. So, I am assuming you also know two words, bending stiffness and torsional stiffness. What is bending stiffness? Right? It's represented as EI. E is Young's modulus, I is second moment of area. Remember, you all remember that. Okay. What's the equivalent thing for torsion? GJ, right? Gj is torsional stiffness, okay. So if the torsional stiffness was infinite, I do not have a problem, okay, we do not have problem. But if the torsional stiffness is not infinite, I have a problem. What is that problem? It will twist, right. So see what has happened now, I am putting this airplane wing in the air and this lift is proportional to angle of attack, okay, this is that proportionality, CL on this side, alpha on this side. If there is a camber, this line goes like this, right. This is how CL, it is almost a straight line except when it starts to, the wing starts to stall, then it is not a straight line, right. So on the other side also it is something like this, and this is called CL alpha or partial CL over partial alpha, okay. So if alpha increases, CL sort of increases linearly, that means lift would increase linearly with alpha. So if I am applying lift here and that lift is a function of angle of attack and I do not have a rigid structure, that means every time this lift increases, the angle of attack increases. Every time the angle of attack increases, the lift increases. Every time the lift increases, the angle of attack increases. So I keep on, I get into this very bad cycle. That is classic instability, okay. Now, at most of the speeds, it is not a big problem. Yes, you would get some additional torsional angle of attack, but you will come to certain limited value, okay. So if you start with an angle of attack equal to alpha, you will get some theta, which is due to flexibility. Okay. But the thing is, and due to flexibility, or you could say Gj value, right. But see, Gj value is finite. Whatever it is, whatever you have designed the wing for, that is what it is. It does not change if I change the air speed. But the value of lift does. But the value of lift does, 1/2 rho v square, right. That means at a certain speed, it is entirely possible that I may not be able to reach this equilibrium. That means at that speed, even what happens is, even a small disturbance then will give you a tiny angle of a tiny increase in lift, but you do not have left any stiffness to resist that tiniest of the torsional moment. Because you do not, cannot resist it, it is going to increase the angle of attack even more. And that means at that speed now, there is no stopping this wing from keep on rotating at a higher and higher and higher angle. So you have become unstable, we call it statically unstable, okay. So that is called divergence speed, all right. So what makes aeroelasticity so different from your normal structural analysis is this equation over here, L equal to 1/2 rho v square S C L, and C L equal to some 0 C L 0 value plus partial C L over partial alpha into alpha, okay. And that alpha is total angle of attack, that means it includes both the angle you set in the beginning, okay, but then flexibility changes that angle because we do not have infinite stiffness. Because lift is in general ahead of elastic axis, this shear center, remember we talked about shear center. So you create this moment, this additional torque, which is L times this distance. That L times this distance changes with the speed, right? Whereas your Gj, which prevents that, it does not. So that means it is possible that at certain speed, you just will, if your angle of attack increases, your torsional, Gj is like a torsional spring, right. It is like as if you apply, you have to apply a moment to cause something to twist, okay. It is like regular spring, but except that it is moment to rotation as opposed to force to distance, what you see in the regular spring. So it is this CL's dependence on alpha and alpha's dependence on flexibility because of lift being at a distance ahead of the elastic axis, that gives us big problems. Okay? So that's why you cannot ignore aerodynamics. Aerodynamics is very important for us. The overall structural design is very important for us. So this interaction is called static aeroelasticity, where aerodynamics impacts structures and structure impacts aerodynamics. Okay. Now the next one we talk about is dynamic aeroelastic, which is time dependent, because now when this wing is rotating like this, there is certain inertia you are overcoming. Okay. When and how that inertia comes into picture then starts to matter. Okay. Then you are not, divergence really assumes things are going very gently like this. Okay. Flutter on the other hand would assume things are oscillating. Okay. When things oscillate, aerodynamics behaves quite differently than it behaves when the wings gradually changes. Okay. Then you start to either extract energy or damp out energy. Okay. So that's what we would see in dynamic aeroelastic phenomena, that how do inertial effects start to come into picture. Okay, so this is from very famous book by Bisplinghoff, Ashley and Hafman. It's called Aeroelasticity. So you could read it yourself, so I don't have to. So why don't you all read it? So the key thing is this line: when structural deformations induce additional aerodynamic forces, that's what happens to our wing, right? The structural deformation, the structural increase in angle of attack, give us additional aerodynamic forces, which then cause the moment to keep on going higher and higher. And it is stable equally, or they tend to diverge and destroy the structure. So this is a very famous diagram of the three inertial forces. So wings go through quite a few aeroelastic processes. So this is a very famous diagram called Collar's triangle of aeroelasticity, COLLAR. So on a triangle you have three vertices: the aerodynamic forces, the elastic forces, and the inertia forces. Inertia means mass, E means elasticity structure, GJEI, and A aerodynamics. Okay. So how these things interact would give you several different kind of phenomena. What we just talked about was divergence. D is divergence. Okay, that's what we talked about. L is simple load acting on the airplane wing, because wing is not one section like I have been showing you. Wing is the whole wing, and different places would behave differently. So what can happen is that you can, by changing the flexibility of the wing, you can change how the load is acting on the wing. Okay, so ideally, because it's a beam, most of the stresses are because of bending in the beam. You really don't want too much load out there, because that's going to cause very large bending moment over here. So you can control your twist in a way that the total lift is lift per unit length over the wing is acting in a way that most of the lift is over here, so that you don't need much bending material. Okay. That's called load distribution. So you can play with the flexibility of the wing to get the kind of load distribution you want. Okay, so that's what this L says, and it's also interaction with aerodynamic forces and elastic forces. F is flutter. Okay, and let's talk about what flutter is now. And again, you should see their pictures of. Tacoma's Narrows Bridge. Just go on the YouTube and you can see it. So what happens is, here is our wing. Okay, and there's somewhere here is your fuselage, and I give this wing a small disturbance. You give it a small disturbance because this system has inertia, it has structures, it would like to vibrate. Okay. So, I give a small disturbance, I leave it over here, it is going to vibrate, but then it is going to sort of die out, the vibration is going to die out, because why do vibrations die out? Damping, right? All systems have damping and wings have a lot of it because of all the rivets and joints and everything. So, they are going to damp out. Now, you increase the speed at which you are flying and give a disturbance again, you will see now it is taking wing longer time to damp out. You increase the speed even more, it is taking even longer to damp out. Then at certain speed, if you give it a disturbance, the system never damps out. It keeps on vibrating at the same frequency, at the same amplitude forever, because whatever damping you had in the system, the way it is now vibrating at that speed, it is extracting enough energy from the air that your damping loss is balancing out by the energy it is extracting from the air. Any increase in speed from this point would simply make this amplitude go up higher and higher in every next cycle. Okay. That is what happened to Tacoma's narrow bridge. Okay. It is not resonance. Okay. Lot of people confuse flutter. Flutter is not resonance. What is resonance? When the excitation, okay. So, this is not that. I mean, all its airplane is, I am not exciting it at all. I am not going there and oscillating wing with a certain frequency. I am doing nothing. All it happens is due to some reason or the other, the wing has developed a small disturbance. Okay. It could be small change in velocity, some turbulence coming in. So, I am not applying any force. See, resonance is, I have a spring mass system with certain natural frequency and I am applying a force to it which is at the same frequency as the natural frequency, and that is resonance. I am not applying any force. It is just some disturbance, I did not even give it that disturbance. It just because things do not stay steady, something changes, right? Some gust might have come or some tiny part fell off the wing, who knows. Some small disturbance simply build up so bad, because in every cycle it is extracting energy from the air, which is just equal to the damping energy, and after that it just keeps on extracting energy, because the energy it is extracting from the air is then higher than the damping energy. Okay. So, that speed is called flutter, and it is a dynamic instability, because the system has a tendency to come back. It is not as if it is, you are giving it a disturbance and it wants to come back, but just that it in the next cycle it goes little more than what the disturbance in the previous cycle was. Okay. So, no matter how small that disturbance is, it could be 0.0001 nanometer, does not matter. Any small disturbance over a number of cycles is going to build up and it is going to make the amplitude go higher and higher. Okay. So, that is what this flutter is, F stands for flutter. B stands for buffeting. Buffeting is not an instability, it really is limit cycle oscillations of sometimes your one of your structures like tail surface or some other thing, it is in the wake of another structure which itself has a lot of turbulence in it. So, it basically is large vibrations which you can feel and which are lasting for a longer time due to either the turbulence in the wake of the structure before it, or in the case of transonic flow, there is an interaction between boundary layer and shock waves, because when speed of sound goes up more than one, some place you will develop shock waves, and that those shock waves with the vibration they start to oscillate, and then there is a boundary layer. How many of you know what a boundary layer is? What is a boundary layer? Flow, right? So it takes certain thickness. If you look, if this is my V coming in, and if I draw a vertical section here and look at the profile of vertical velocity over here, whatever that velocity is, it's not like this. It's not like this, right? Why it's not like that? Why it cannot be like that? No, but shear stresses are caused. No, even not viscosity. At this point, the velocity has to be 0, right? So it has to go from here to here in a certain, okay. So what happens is, but this goes from here to the mean one pretty rapidly, okay. So even though I have drawn like this, it could be more like this, okay. So it's a very sharp gradient near the surface, and then it becomes almost no gradient, right? And because only then you develop a lot of shear stresses or shear drag, okay. So this is called boundary layer. So essentially what we can say is that it is as if this airfoil is not of this shape, it is slightly different shape. This is slightly different shape, okay. Then we would say on this part fluid is as if there is no viscosity, it's at the constant speed, but all the action due to viscosity is in this small layer called boundary layer, okay. And over here partial u over partial eta, eta is this direction, is very large, okay. It is, see how fast it's going from 0 to some large value over a very tiny distance, okay. So that's called boundary layer. So when you build shocks, there is interaction between the boundary layer after the shock, and that when shock moves, boundary layer can go bigger, smaller, and what happens is then there's certain part of the boundary layer that are not as smooth. They're not laminar. Laminar means it just very gradually goes. The layers very gradually move one over the other. Okay. So it loses a lot of momentum. As a result, the shock and boundary layers start to interact each other, the shocks keep on moving back and forth, and the boundary layer keeps on increasing and decreasing, and the flow becomes turbulent, and that can excite the structure, okay. So it is as if you are applying a steady load at a certain frequency now onto the wing, that wing itself, okay. So that is buffeting. So it really is interaction between again the mass of the wing, because wing is vibrating, interaction between the aerodynamic forces and the interaction between the elastic forces, okay. But it is not instability. By that what it means is the amplitude is not going to increase with every cycle. It is going to be constant in every cycle, but it could be pretty large, okay. And the buffeting is just inconvenience. Imagine sitting in an airplane where wing is oscillating pretty bad, okay. But it's better than fluttering. You definitely don't want to sit in an airplane which is fluttering, but you know, even oscillating one can be pretty painful. So that buffeting you have to be watch for, and all airfoils, modern airfoils, because all modern airplanes, they fly in transonic range. That means Mach number anywhere from 0.85 to 0.91, 0.92, right? So it's the possibility of buffeting happening. The interaction between the shock wave and the boundary layer are so high that you have to watch for them. Okay, and there are empirical relations. It's hard to predict mathematically at what angle buffeting will take place, because it's not only related to aerodynamics, although aerodynamics plays the major role. Okay, because you have to have Navier-Stokes equations to, only then you can simulate it, okay, because you need to know how the boundary layer develops, you need to know how the turbulence develops and all that. So you need to have very sophisticated aerodynamics and compressible effects. Okay, that means you cannot use incompressible fluid flow to calculate your buffeting. Okay, this dynamic instability of that's of the whole airplane. Okay, that's of the whole airplane, which is essentially is not aeroelastic phenomena. It's more stability and control issue of the airplane. That would an airplane, if you give it a small disturbance, I'm no longer talking about the wing alone. I'm talking about the whole airplane. That if I give the wing, the airplane a small disturbance, would it that disturbance die out or not? Okay, and there are three kinds of instabilities. Again, you can talk about one in pitching, that if you give a disturbance like this, would it die out? One in roll. I'm sorry, roll is this, right? If the airplane rolls slightly, would it come back or would it start to go back and forth? You know. So, but most of the airplanes are very stable. Okay, they have, that's why you have control surfaces. So the wings make sure that if one wing starts to go down, the angle of attack on it increases, and then it starts to come back. Okay, so rolling is that. For pitching, what do we do to make airplane stable in pitch? The elevators in the back, right? So if it starts to go a little up, on the elevator is going to face a higher angle of attack. It's going to develop a lift. That lift will pull it up, right? So that's why you have big tail surfaces in the back. If those tail surfaces were not there, airplane would not be stable in pitch. Okay, so you have the wing itself acting to control rolling. That elevator would make sure that it does not pitch become unstable in pitching. How about yaw? This is called yaw motion. The rudder in the back. Okay, so that's why you see that big thing going up on the back of the airplane. That makes sure that the wing does not go unstable in yaw either. Okay, and Z is just dynamic response. It's transient response of aircraft components produced by rapidly applied load due to gust, landing, gun reactions, abrupt control motions, moving shock waves, extra. Okay. We talked about load distribution, angle of attack changes the load distribution. You can control how you make the wing change its angle of attack. That way you can put lot of load towards the root of the wing, then bending moments become smaller, and then you don't need as much material. We did talk about divergence. It's a static instability of a lifting surface at a speed called the divergence speed, where elasticity of lifting surfaces play an important role in the instability. So we have talked about that. Okay, so let's now any questions about various aeroelastic phenomena we have studied so far? I mean, what is aeroelasticity? You guys have some handle on what it's all about? Anybody has any question?
So what about the biplanes?
What about the biplanes?
The rigidity, why did biplanes were scrapped? Because it was flatter or?
No, it was not, they were scrapped. It's just people didn't want to build two wings. It was not as much structural problem as it was a cost thing. Two wings are expensive than one wing. Okay. It depends. Biplanes are we do have now materials and structures that can take economically. Obviously, the monoplane is better. That's why we build them. But structurally, perhaps biplanes were better because you are not lifting as much lift on each one of them. But the problem is interference between the two wing was, you know, there can be a lot of drag due to interference. So that's why people went away from them too. Maintenance. So when it comes to design like that, there are many issues. Any other questions? Okay. So let's do a very quick and dirty analysis of divergence. So let's suppose you have this airfoil, right? And we are representing all our entire torsional resistance by a spring called KT. Okay, KT has, if you apply a moment to this wing, it will get, it will twist by an angle theta, and moment would be KT times theta. Just like force equal to spring constant multiplied by displacement of the spring, rotational springs behave the same way. You know, you apply a moment and you will get some angle of twist. So these things we have talked about, there is a lift, there is a moment, and when we talk about divergence, we really do not care about drag, because drag is very, very small compared to lift for aircraft wings. So L over D, we call it, L over D is generally of the order of anywhere from 10 to 20, you know. So you do not have to worry about drag when you calculate divergence. Then there is this very interesting point for airfoils called aerodynamic center. So when you talk about aerodynamic loads on wing, first of all, they are very complicated. Okay, I do not want to make give you an impression that all you see is one L, one M and one D. This is not what happens. Okay, there is a whole series, whole kind of things happening on the wing. You have a pressure distribution changing every point, right. What we have done is, what we have said is, if I have a wing which has a very large aspect ratio, what is an aspect ratio? Span over, measure of how big is your span, okay. Oh, now many people have, I hope you do not have that misperception. Span is from tip to tip, it is not length of the wing, one wing itself, okay. So span means you go from one end to the other end, that is called span. So it is ratio of span to the chord, some kind of measure of that, okay. So that, so if the wing are very, have a very large aspect ratio, what it means is we can deal with them as one dimensional structures, like beam, a combination of a beam and a torque carrying rod. So for those kind of things, and the other thing in this whole analysis we are assuming is sweep is also small, so I can live with the one dimensional structure. Although later on we will talk about how to take care of sweep in our aeroelastic calculations. So coming back to this aerodynamic center, so all our aerodynamic forces, the pressure distribution essentially, can be written as an some kind of integrated value in terms of lift, in terms of pitching moment. M is called pitching moment. And we assume that it acts on the aerodynamic center. Okay. So my question to you was, what is aerodynamic center? So all that pressure distribution I showed you guys, you know, it looks like this. What we are saying is, we know that it is changing from point to point and it is different on the top surface and on the bottom surface. But for the kind of analysis we are trying to do, I really do not need this kind of knowledge. I do not need to know where, what pressure acts at what point. All I want to know is, what is lift, what is drag, and what is pitching moment. For my one dimensional analysis, that is all I need. If I was doing a plate analysis, so if the aspect ratio goes down and you do not, you cannot model your wing as a beam, then you will have to model like a plate. Okay. For example, if you are designing a fighter airplane like Dr. Mathi was, he would not be modeling that wing using a beam, he will be modeling using a plate. Okay. So, but for us, these three are the only main three components: lift, moment, and aerodynamics. Okay. And so, I was talking about this interesting point called aerodynamic center. What do you think aerodynamic center is?
It is the point about which the Cm0 does not change with alpha.
Okay. So, see lift, remember we talked about lift, that it changes with alpha. At any other point, if I do not take all this lift and moment at that point. See, what I'm doing really is I'm taking this lift moment, so this pressure distribution, and I'm converting into a three values: lift, pitching moment, and drag. Okay. So what, and the value of the lift will not change if I change the point. Okay. If whether I take this as a reference point or this as a reference point, lift will not change, because that is the net effect in terms of force of the pressure. Okay. That does not change. The drag also would not change, but by making this reference point different, what I am changing is the value of Cm. If I pick what is called center of pressure, what would be the value of Cm at center of pressure? 0, right? But the problem, I am not, it would be, life would be very simple, that if I pick, if I am able to pick center of pressure, life is simple, Cm is 0. But the problem is I can't pick Cp, because the moment I would change my angle of attack, their Cp changes. Okay. But the aerodynamic center does not change. Okay. So its value is, it remains same, and the Cm does not change. Okay. Because Cm does not change, and because the angle of so we like to convert all these pressure forces into a lift acting through the aerodynamic center, a moment acting through the aerodynamic center, and lift would change with the angle of attack, but this moment will not change with the angle of attack. It remains fixed, and you would see that it is a huge simplification for us, that when the wing would twist more because of this lift, I do not have to worry about Cm, I only have to worry about lift, right. So this is a basic, very simple math model. Now you have an airfoil section at an angle of attack at alpha, and because this point is because I have my spring over here, I have some moment acting which is lift times this distance EC, right, and because of that this wing would deflect additionally, let us call that angle theta. Okay. If k of t was infinity, that means it is very rigid, theta would be 0. Okay. But theta is not 0 when k of t is not 0, not infinite, I am sorry. So, I think they are giving me a signal that I need to stop. So, we will stop here and come back after 5 minutes. What is our plan now? You guys going to have a break now or later on? Okay, break. Okay, so we'll come back to this analysis after the break.